Let me formally introduce myself. This is Suman from India. I volunteered Mozilla as Mozilla Tech Speaker. And the talk today, which I'm going to be telling about, is about the vulnerabilities which are posing threat for the web applications. So before doing that, so over the past 10 years, the web as we know today has been significantly improved. Along with the evolution of the web, the hackers' proficiency has also increased. In the current generation, their goals have also been changed. The primary goal of each hacker today is stealing money. It can be in terms of real money, or it can be the data that worth millions of dollars. So the sole responsibility of protecting the user from such incidents lies with the application developers. And when I'm talking about the web applications, it lies with the web developers. So today I'm going to be speaking about the vulnerabilities which are posing threat for the web application. And those top 10 vulnerabilities are from the OWASP. They have listed them out. And the first vulnerability among that would be the injection flaw. So about the injection flaw, this flaw occurs when the untrusted data has been sent to the interpreter as part of a code or a command. So in the course of during this talk, I will be talking more about I will be using the untrusted data. This will be the term which I will be using mostly. So what is injection flaw? Any guesses about, does anyone talk about the injection flaw? Does anybody know about the injection flaw? Okay. So actually, what happens is, when the untrusted data is sent to the interpreter, it will trick the interpreter in such a way to perform unintentional operations, or the operations which will be giving unauthorized access to the data. So injection flaws are of many types. One is OS injection, and this SQL injection. So when I'm talking about the SQL injections, what is SQL injection is very common type of injection flaw. And it is extremely common as well as extremely deadly. So what SQL injection means, let me show you. So here what happens in the SQL, you can know about this is first one is the SQL and this is the HSQL. In those both queries you can see that we are requesting select all from the account where the customer ID is something. So in this particular ID place, if I fill like this, if the hacker is going to fill it like this, what happens? You are here. What happens here is you're here tricking the interpreter to take the unauthorized access to that query, and you're performing this. So at the last, what will be happening is hacker will be successfully making SQL injection flaw. That is how he will be feeling. So what happened here? In the SQL injection, from the injection flaws, there will be information leakage, disclosure of data, and these are all will be the goals which the hacker will be receiving. And next one will be the second one will be the broken authentication session management. This flaw occurs when application functions related to the authentication and session management are not implemented correctly. What does it mean by? So this is one of the extremely deadly attack, and when it happens, let me show you. Okay. So yeah. So this flaw arises when the application which I'm talking about. Okay. Just give me a second. Yeah, perfect. This flaw can be extremely serious in the web application and can put the business at very high risk. It will put the company at the high risk by losing the confidential data, and also it will open the backdoors for the companies to further malicious attacks. So what does it mean? So when an attacker is successful in this flaw, he will be accessing the accounts of the, he can access anything an account holder can has permission to do with. So why this law, why this flaw is always listed in the OWASP top 10 list year by year? It is because the company either believes that there won't be any security breach happening to them, or the company is they may not have find the talented security and development professionals to build the code securely in the first place. So that is about the broken this flaw. So let me tell you the small example on how this flaw is exploited. For example, if the hacker has got has hacked into the user account, and if he got the permission to do whatever the account holder can do, he can, for example, say there is a online shopping website which is vulnerable to this application, this flaw. So what happens here is a hacker can order items for himself, and he can order orders for himself. The items goes to his house, and the bill goes to the user. So how does it feel? This is how the user feels after he got the bill to his house, when he don't know what happened. Just so that will be what this will be the hacker goals that will be coming if the vulnerability name is broken authentication. And the third one would be XSS scripting. So let me try to tell what this is about. So when the XSS scripting is nothing but when the application allows the untrusted data and it sends to the victim's browser, then this flaw occurs. So what does it mean? So here, what you can see is the attacker will send his malicious script, and it will be stored in the website. When that particular website is being accessed through the victim's browser, say for example a request has been given to the website. In the response part, the website will send you the response along with that malicious script attached to it. So the user won't know what exactly is happening, because in the background, in the malicious script, there can be something like here you can see it is asking for the cookies information. This cookies information will be going to the attacker server, and the user will don't know what happened exactly. So this is XSS scripting, and the hacker's goals will be the cookie stealing, alert popping, pop-up message, and everything. So what is next? Insecure direct object reference. So what happens here, this flaw has become common with the increased complexity of the web application, where each web application enables the user to access some components but not the others. What I meant to say is this flaw occurs when this flaw is called the direct object reference. This will occur when the developer exposes the internal implementation of an implementation object such as file or directory publicly. So to know about this, this flaw can be easily detected. How it can be detected means, say for example, the testers needs to identify the user, identify the input fields in his application where the data can be sent. So that the tester will, so let me try to explain like this. So there is a web application is there, and there are some, say web form is part of the web application. So in that place, testers can go and they can put some payload and check whether this kind of flaw is there or not. So that is about insecure data object reference. See here. In this prepared statement, you can see there is something called get parameter. Tester can test this by putting something like not my account, something like that. And if this is, and if this URL is executed by the browser without validations, then it will result in the insecure data object reference. next comes the security misconfiguration. So security misconfiguration, let me try to explain that. So do you know about the application stack? What does the, exactly the application stack contains? Let me tell you. It contains a platform, web server, application server, database, framework, and custom code. We have these many levels. There can be anything like, for example, there's a Tomcat server is there. In the when you install a server, they will be having a default admin accounts. If you don't disable those default admin accounts, for example, there will be the default account can have admin and password. The admin username as admin and password as password. If you don't disable such type of accounts, hacker can get to them to the application. So that is something called a security misconfiguration, and this has actually recently exploited. Do you know in the New York Stewart Airport, those server has been exposed to security misconfiguration, and their servers were open for 1 year. They were not secured, and this flaw was recently recently known. So this is what I am talking about. If the app server admin console is automatically installed, it will have some default accounts. So you need to disable such default accounts, or if you need to change the default login credentials which you have. Next one is sensitive data exposure. So before saying about sensitive data exposure, let me tell you that data can be classified into two ways. That is data at rest. Data at rest is nothing but data stored in the servers, data being transmitted. So the transmission of data can be happening between the server and server, or between the server and the browser. When this data is not stored using proper encryption methods, say for example weak algorithms, then that will lead to the sensitive data exposure. So here, the example here we can see that, for example, there is a login authentication page which doesn't use SSL certification. So that will leave the transfer of data without proper encryption method, and the attacker can play a role as interceptor between the server and browser, and he can take the data out. Next, coming to this one, machine functional level access control. So what does this mean? Any guesses? Anyone? So in most web applications, what does it mean? Most web applications, what does they do means they check the functional level access rights before making the functionalities visible in UI. So the same kind of functionality checks needs to be done on the server side before they are being sent to the browser. If that doesn't happen, it will lead to the missing functional level access control vulnerability. Let me try to explain this with the real-time example which I have already used. So in my college portal, when the results have been announced, so my college website has this vulnerability, and we have taken advantage of that. So when the results were announced, say what we used to do is something like xyz.university/progress-report/my-hall-ticket-number. Then let's say this scenario: if that URL is, if we enter that URL, my progress card will be generated. If I change at the above my hall ticket number to some other, say 97 to 99, that URL also has been accessed for me. So what happening there means it is the victim of this vulnerability. So that's the thing. Next, cross-site vulnerability. So I will explain the CSRF by four steps. Let me tell you. For example, in the first step, victim gonna browse the web page managed by attacker. So there is a web page which will be managed by attacker, and victim uses that. And say, for example, in that web page, if there is a bad image is there, if user don't know that, that image is that image is attached with a malicious script, and when the user presses the image, what happens means it will send the information to the attacker, attaching all the cookies, whatever the script has, that will be gone to the attack victims, that will be gone to the attacker's server. So that is CSRF. So this is what I'm talking about. So for example, that is that is some URL which is managed by web attacker and if the attacker knows that, he can change the destination account to his account, and it can be exploited. And using components with known vulnerabilities. So the thing is, we all know that we are in using the third party, using the third party applications will make the developer team's life easier. But you need to take care that whenever you are using a third party component in your website, then you need to check if there are any vulnerabilities in that third party components time to time. So there are some portals where they will show you if the particular component has any vulnerabilities, and they will release the patches. So you need to check at regular intervals whether there is any vulnerability happening for your third party component, and you need to update it at regular intervals so that you cannot be the victim of this vulnerability. One of the well-known and very famous vulnerability is Heartbleed. So this happened in the OpenSSL library. This flaw happened in OpenSSL library from, say, version 1.0.1 to 1.0.1f. So with that vulnerability, hackers have extracted the encrypted information. The last one would be unvalidated redirects and forwards. So what does it mean? So if you have been into some, say, like if you're watching some pirated online movies, I won't say the website names, but there are some websites where you can watch the movies online. So if you go to them, and you can say, if you click on the link, there will be some pop-ups happening. So most of the people nowadays use ad blocker for not getting those pop-ups. If you click one of the pop-ups, there might be a chance that you will be redirected to the malicious web page. So that's need to be taken care of. This is known as unvalidated redirects and forwards. See, for example, if that is some vulnerable page, if you click on the one of the pop-up which you are getting in the web page, that may redirect it to the such vulnerable web page. So next, coming to the Open Web Application Security Tools. So the first one which I am going to be telling you about is Vega Scanner. So this is one of the open security tools which is built in Java. It has its own GUI environment where you can do the work. So, but it does not provide, generate any PDF format reports. So what the Vega Scanner can do is these are all the tests that Vega Scanner can perform. And next come the OpenVAS. This is another thing which I'm talking about earlier. So this tool has been developed in Java, in Python. It doesn't have any GUI environment, but it is available for Windows, Macintosh, and Linux projects, Linux OS systems. The thing is, since it doesn't have any GUI environment, you can use it for your personal use, but not for the team projects. So if your web application is a small project, you can use this. And yeah, that's pretty much about this one. And next comes the Zattack proxy, which we will be doing a live demo on this one. So Zattack proxy, I personally use it. The thing is, Zattack proxy can also be used for learning purpose. If you're starting as a beginner in the penetration domain, you can use this tool, and you can learn from start. You can start learning from this tool. So these are the ZAP features. It's a cross-platform one and it's easy to install. You can just download a .exe file and you can install it on your own. And it's it has technical documentations. Wherever if you feel that you have some doubts, we have enough well-documented, it's well-documented. So it is community-based. It has its own community so that if you have any doubts, you can go into IRC channel and you can ping them. They will be helpful for you. And these are pretty much the attacks which Zap can perform. So we have big list actually. So let me show you the demo. So this is the Zap ZAP UA which I'm talking about. So what happens is, this tool can be typically divided into three divisions. This is the place where you can see what are the sites you are visiting when you proxy it with a particular browser. It can be a Firefox browser or a Google Chrome. And this is the place where you can see the request and response. When we are doing it, you will come to know about that. And you will have a quick start tab here where you can directly enter a URL and you can start attacking it. And this is the place where the results will be shown. For example, if you are making a fuzzing or you are performing a AJAX spidering or ActiveScan, any attacks, you can see the URLs here and you can see in the alert tab what are the vulnerabilities. So let me try to perform to a attack and let me show you how this can be worked out. So before that, what I'm doing, Luis. So I have a vulnerable application known as Budget Store. I'm gonna attack that Budget Store using the ZAP, and I will show you how the usage of the ZAP tool. First, okay. I have hosted this vulnerable application on Tomcat server, so I just started it. So it is very easy to proxy a web browser to the ZAP tool. Let me show you how that one also. So before you perform anything here, what you must do is first you need to proxy the browser with this tool. How to proxy it? Go to the tools, go to the options. Here you can see something called local proxy. Here you need to set the same port number here as well as to this browser as well. So here is Azure AD1. So you need to proxy it with the web browser as well. Go to the tools, go to the options. So I'm using Firefox for this one. So advanced. So this is the place you will be setting the proxy. So the port number should be same with the tool as well as to the browser. So after proxying with it, now we can use this browser for testing purposes. So initially I have started the Tomcat server. In the Tomcat server, there will be a folder known as web apps. In the web apps, you need to host the web application. So I already copied the code of that vulnerable application in the web apps folder. Now I'm trying to do that. So, this is the vulnerable application which I'm talking about. So, when I browse something here, say for example home, you can see what are the URLs you have visited in this section. Okay. I'm gonna perform a AJAX spidering. What do you mean by spidering? It is something, it is nothing but web crawling. So when you want to crawl a dynamic website, some AJAX, you need to use AJAX spidering. So there is a add-on called as CrawlJAX that has been integrated with the AJAX spider. So that will make, that will help you in efficient way of crawling the AJAX website. So how you can do that? You can add the, these are the attacks which you are available and which you can perform. So you can add the Ajax Spider here, click on the budget, go for the settings, select the browser which you have been proxied with, and set the number of browsers windows to open to three, and let's just configure it. After configuring the Ajax Spider tab, go to the budget, go to attack, and click on Ajax Spider, and start the scan. So the scan has started. Let me show you. So, how many of you know about fuzzing attack? So it is nothing but going for a using a payload.txt file, and something it is like something like a brute force method to get into an authenticated page. Click on this, go for start. You should see here, since we have a selected number of windows to be 3, there will be 3 windows opening, and simultaneously it will perform automated web crawling. That is, web crawling is automated. It will, what web crawler will do is, it will crawl to the each hyperlink present in the web application, and it will index them. So this one is first one. So this is the second window which I am talking about. After completion of this attack, you can see all the URLs present here in this session. So now you can see why this area is used for. The results of the each attack will be displayed here. So the thing is, all the the windows will be closing when the attack has been completed. Since the attack has been completed, all the windows are closed now. So at the same time, you can see here alerts. In the alert, these are the vulnerabilities which are present. So for example, see this one. If you double click on that, it will tell you what is the vulnerability, the description of the vulnerability, how you what is the solution for the vulnerability. And this is something like, if you click on the save button, this will be generated as a report in a .pdf format, which you can send it to the developer team. If you are in the tester team, if you have tested it, and if you find this vulnerability, you can write you can edit the fields as well according to your requirement, and then you can click the save button. This PDF can be sent to the developers so that they can see this vulnerability and they can rectify that. So this means that this tool has a facility called report generation. I can say that. And the next thing which I would like to show you is fuzzing. First, we'll go to the new session. Here, let me try to log in. Something like voxed. So why did I did that? So whatever that thing which we have done here, this will be reflected in the ZAP. So you can see here in the request tab, you can see that I have entered this UI input. So if you double click on and if you try to say fuzz here, it will open a window where you can add payroll. So what exactly you are doing is, in this column you will be sending a number of values. If any one of the value is true, it will get that page will get authenticated and it will go into the it will cross the authentication. So let me select a one.txt file which contains the words, some alphanumeric passwords, set of alphanumeric passwords which this will be working on. So say for example fuzzdb, you can find the payload.txt number of .txt files online. You can just download them and you can just attach it here. So for example, I wanna use something like list user password and save surrounding passwords, john.txt. So these are all the values which I'm talking on. Each value will be going to that input field and it will try to get through the authentication. So let me add this file and let me start the fuzzer. So it will be going on. So it will take time, but let me tell you what happens. So you can see here the same, the response body has same size here. So if the attack is successful, you can see something like increased value here. So that means you are into the web page. You are into, you have crossed the login module and you are into the web application. So for example, if I clicked it, you can see here it tried to pass buddy and it tried to chop something, other word. So it will do the thing, so what happens here, it will do this kind of thing till the end, till all the words in the .txt file has been executed, and it will see, you will see the result here. So that's about OWASP ZAP. And later, after ZAP, we have one more. There is something other open source security tool called as SQL Mapper. So the name itself will tell you that this SQL Mapper can be used for doing SQL injection on a particular web page. So if that is successful, it will tell you where, at which part the which part is not secure. So that is about SQL Mapper. And just, do you have any questions regarding what I have regarding the session? Tell me.
Do you have any more plans for the ZAP tool? What's the future plans for the ZAP tool? Are you developing it further?
We are adding add-ons for that. We have one add-on market, where you can see all the developments. If there is an add-on, newly added add-on is there, we will be displaying in the add-on pack. Let me show you how to add the add-on, so that if there is any functionality, we will be adding as an add-on to the tool. So this is the, so you can see this small icon here. If you click on this, these are all the add-ons we are having at the marketplace. Okay. So let me show you. So this is the icon. This small icon is there, right? This is the wait for the add-on marketplace for this particular tool. So here you can see, okay, we haven't connected to the internet. You can see the list of add-ons here. So if there is functionality, that will be added here, and you can install it. These are the install add-ons which we have already. So by default, this will be installed when you install the tool itself. So these are the basic tools which basic add-ons which needs to be having. So yeah. Any more?
What are the differences between those? You showed, I think, three tools. You said you particularly like Zap.
Yes.
Why would you use one over another?
For example, if I if you go to the Vega scanner, which I am talking about, it has GUI interface, but the OpenVAS doesn't have the GUI interface. You need to use a command prompt for that. So if you are using a personal web application, if you are building a web application as your own, you can personally use it for that. So, and also OpenVAS don't have report generation facility. So that's why you need to use it for your personal use. Yeah. Okay then, thank you.